I've recently made a website called Archives of Pandemonium. This video is going to be talking in some pretty technical terms about how I made an algorithm to simulate the so-called Library of Babel. Before watching this video, I recommend you check out what I've made at archives.oneiero.com. The Library of Babel is a short story written by Argentine author Jorge Luis Borges about a universe which is basically just a huge library. In this library, every possible 420-page book exists somewhere. This world consists of a huge array of hexagons, each containing 5 shelves per wall and 32 books per shelf. I can really recommend reading the story because it explores some interesting philosophical aspects of this concept. With modern technology, it's possible to make an actual digital version of this library. A guy named Jonathan Basile created the website libraryofbabel.info, which does an extremely good job of staying true to the original short story. On the site, you can choose any of the countless hexagons, choose a wall, a shelf, a book, and a page. The contents of each page is fixed to that address, and Basile ensures us that they're not simply randomly generated and loaded up when the same page is requested twice. This wouldn't work for two reasons. One, this doesn't ensure that the same content can't exist in two different places, and each page is supposed to be unique. And two, this approach limits how many pages you could theoretically see by being bound to the disk size of the server. His site also lets you search, which is a really interesting feature. While I was using the site, I came to realize that the original concept very poorly conveys the scale of this virtual library. You don't quite get how many hexagons there are, and I think that in part is because of how disproportionately the choices you make are distributed. Let me explain. First of all, you have to choose a hexagon. I'll get back to that later. Then you choose a wall, of which there are 4 options. Then a shelf, where there are 5 options. A book, where there are 32 options. And finally a page, of which there are 410 options. This means that within each hexagon is contained 262,400 options. Great, but how many unique pages actually exist in total? Well, each page consists of 3200 characters, with 29 options each. That's 29 to the power of 3200 options for each page. Thanks to Wolfram Alpha, we can tell that this leaves 36 to the power of 3105 options for the hexagon number. In fact, on the Library of Babel website, you can enter 3360 letters and numbers for the hexagon address, which is even more data than the actual page you end up reading. That's almost unavoidable though. For every combination of letters to exist, you need the address, that is, the input, to be as big as the text at the end, the output. What felt really unsatisfactory to me though, was the fact that you basically just had to input one big text for the hexagon, and then make a tiny, insignificant choice at the end. I wanted a version which gave the user a series of equally sized choices to end up at a single predetermined text. So I set out to make my own. What I ended up making is called the Archives of Pandemonium. First of all, we need to decide on some variables. What we need to figure out is, which characters does our algorithm output? How many characters does our algorithm output? How many choices do I want the user to make? And what kind of address does the user need to input? I decided to go for a smaller scope, since I wanted an even distribution of options per choice. I had the idea of making a complete library of every possible tweet, so I decided to make my output a length of 160 characters, 140 for the tweet and 20 for the username. Then I decided to use a power of 2 for the amount of characters, since it makes some of the math prettier. Therefore, I wanted 32 characters, 26 letters and 6 different punctuation marks. I also included a hashtag, since we are talking about tweets. This means that our output space has the size 32 to the power of 160. And because I used the power of 2 for the base, it nicely converts into binary as 2 to the power of 800. That's 800 bits. I decided it would be reasonable to have the user make a choice 8 times. That's a lot of choices, but it also underscores the size of this imaginary library. This means that each time the user inputs part of an address, they're inputting 100 bits. If I just let them input a number, that would look like this. I thought that number was a bit too large to seem comprehensible to the user, so I condensed the first 50 bits of the address into 10 letters, making the final address look like this. Then, we just need to make up some fiction about what the choices represent. For example, I tell the user that the first choice is the address of a train station they want to go to. Then, it's the floor that an elevator will take them to, and so on. So that's the client side. The user inputs 8 of these addresses and gets an 800-bit number. It just needs to be converted into the text to display. I call this the Babble algorithm. It has a few requirements. 1. The output number should be unrecognizable from the input number. 2. One small change in the address should completely change the text so that the messages feel shuffled. 3. The algorithm needs to work both ways so we can do a search. That means a text should be able to translate to an address. The third property gives us a nice security. If the input space, that is, the amount of numbers we can put into our algorithm, is the exact same size as our output space, we can ensure that we don't get any duplicates, and therefore, every single combination definitely exists somewhere. After all, if two inputs gave the same output, that output couldn't uniquely be converted back to one single input. So how did I do this? To explain my result, I need to talk a bit about some experimentation. First, I decided I'd be able to apply a bunch of reversible bitwise operations to the 800-bit number, like bit shifting, reversing, and inverting. If I did the same operations in the reverse order, I'd be able to reconstruct the input given some output. This meets the first and third criteria, but since every bit still corresponds to some other position of the original number, changing just one bit, such as incrementing the address by 1, would also only change one bit of the output, only affecting a single letter. I messed around with doing the operations in different bases than binary, but that didn't lead anywhere. I thought about how, ideally, I'd be able to take every combination of 800 bits and map them to some other combination of 800 bits. But the whole point is that there are too many combinations to possibly store on any device. Then I got an idea. What if I could map chunks of the number, like every combination of the first 12 bits to some other combination of 12 bits? After all, there are only 4096 combinations of those, and it's relatively cheap to generate all of them and shuffle them 67 times. So a single change in the last bit would completely change the last 12 bits. And if I used the numeric value of those 12 bits as a seed for how to shuffle the next chunk, all the following chunks would completely change as well. But because I'm using the resulting value as the seed, I can still reconstruct the maps from just the output value. Combine that with also doing some randomized bitwise operations as I talked about before, and I have a pretty good system which meets all of my criteria. From there, it was pretty trivial to make the front-end functionality, things like search and converting the output 800 bits into 160 characters. My first encounter with the Library of Babel was when I was watching Weihart's video 12 Tones, where she mentioned searching through the Library of Babel as an analogy to navigating the infinitely branching tree that occurs when writing or composing music or any other creative field. I decided to include that as a theme in Archives of Pandemonium and present it more as a game experience than a website. I hope you enjoyed and found this video useful. Cheers!